Welcome to Prostate 101. Thank you so much for taking time out of your day to join us today. My name is Dr. Ben Wilkinson. I'm a radiation oncologist and medical director here at Provision Care's Cancer Center. And today we're going to talk about some of the basics regarding prostate cancer detection, diagnosis, and some of the elements of treatment. Our summary today, we'll talk about some prostate cancer facts, how we diagnose prostate cancer, the specific stage and risk groups that we use to make medical decisions, as well as the genomics and genetics that are important in prostate cancer management. One of the options, active surveillance, as well as some of the main treatment modalities that we use to treat prostate cancer. So important to say that prostate cancer is the number one cancer in men. There are 174 cases, 1,000 cases that are diagnosed every year, and it is the number one cancer cause of death in men. A lot of times we hear about prostate cancer being a cancer that you may die with but not die from, but that's actually not correct. There are definitely men with prostate cancer that can be detected at a late stage and can progress and take their life, so we do need to take it seriously. It's most common in older men, especially as we get over the age of 60, although prostate cancer can be diagnosed in the 40s and as well as in the 50s. Definitely have seen cases in those age brackets. And we often get a question about what kind of causes are related to prostate cancer. Usually it's a random mutation, but it can be related to animal fat intake, red meat, and high testosterone. We also know that it can run in families, so if someone's brother or father or multiple family members have been diagnosed with prostate cancer, it can be related, and especially if those family members were under the age of 60. There are inherited syndromes, including the BRCA BRCA2 gene that can be related specifically fit with family, so not just breast cancer, but can also cause prostate cancer as well. American males, there's a 16% risk of diagnosis, so 2.9% risk of death from prostate cancer. So more people are going to be diagnosed than are going to die from it, but still can be a fatal disease. And the risk of prostate cancer definitely increases with age. So at a 55-year-old, 30% risk of prostate cancer versus 80-year-old, it's going to increase. So most of the cases are going to happen as someone ages, especially over the age of 60. A typical workup, we will start with a PSA, and it's important to say that PSA screening is still recommended, typically beginning at the age of 40, but you definitely want to talk with your primary care provider or urologist about when to begin in your family. We typically want to obtain that before a rectal exam, and physical exam we would also want to do on that initial test. There are some additional imaging that can be done between having an elevated PSA and when we would actually do a biopsy. This can be a multi-parametric 3 Tesla or high resolution MRI. Undergoing a biopsy, if the PSA is elevated and suspicious on more than one occasion, and also if we see a lesion on MRI. One of the neat advancements that's happened recently is that MRIs can be used to guide biopsies either through an MR fusion with an ultrasound system, or potentially actually inside of the MRI unit, and that allows us to be much more precise about targeting the lesion as opposed to doing a random biopsy. In certain cases, we'll also use a bone scan or CT scan, and in the future, we will use PET scans as we do in other cancers at the initial time of diagnosis, either an Oxumin or potentially a PSMA, and then whole body MRI is also an area of future imaging potential. So when we talk about stage and grade, it's important to say that for prostate cancer, we actually give both. So it's not just one number or one designation, but we'll actually give both. Stage is an overall combination of clinical factors. So in prostate cancer, it's the PSA, it's the physical exam, and it's also the Gleason score, or what the prostate cancer looks like under the microscope. A lot of family members or friends you might have may have been diagnosed with cancers, and they are going to be familiar with the stage 1 to 4, and that's the overall stage group. So we'll talk about how we determine that. There's also the grade, or what the cancer appears under the microscope, and that's the Gleason score, and we'll go into detail about how that is determined. So staging will begin with the PSA, and again, screening should begin at age 40. Typically, a PSA above 4 is considered abnormal. We also look at the free PSA to the total PSA, and in general, if the free PSA is less than 25%, then that can become suspicious. It's important to also note that as a PSA rises over time, so even if it hasn't crossed the 4 threshold, if it's changed significantly, gone from, let's say, 2.2 to 3.8 in 1 year, that might indicate that something has changed and that needs to be investigated further. So here in this diagram, we're looking at why PSA might change in a detectable level in the bloodstream. So when prostate cancer is not present or inflammation is not present for within a prostate, the PSA is made, but it's not shared with the bloodstream. It doesn't leak out of the bloodstream, and it then wouldn't be detected on a laboratory test. But as you can see in the lower part of the screen, with prostate cancer, there is crowding of the cells and disruption of the basement membrane, and that's when the PSA molecules can leak out into the bloodstream and then be detectable. There are other reasons for PSA to be elevated in a large prostate. So benign prostatic hypertrophy, or BPH, is one of the reasons that men might have an elevated PSA and not actually have prostate cancer. PSA also will increase with age, so an older patients might have higher PSAs than younger men. Prostatitis, which is inflammation of the prostate, is a very common reason. That can be viral, it can be bacterial. There's multiple reasons. Definitely prostate cancer, recent sexual activity, a rectal exam, or potentially even cycling, because the pressure of the saddle on the perineum can increase the PSA. And so one of the things to think about is that if someone's PSA is elevated, instead of immediately moving to a biopsy, sometimes it makes sense to consider some of these other reasons that the PSA could be up and see if we can address that before confirming that someone needs to move on to a biopsy. So that might look like repeating the PSA in a week to 2 weeks, might be starting someone on antibiotics, depending on the details or symptoms someone's having. So definitely talk with your doctor if you have a single PSA that's elevated, and potentially if there's a way that the PSA could be rechecked safely before going to biopsy. So the question of whether to biopsy or not, if you have an elevated PSA, our perspective would be to only biopsy if the PSA is elevated on more than one occasion. There are certain scenarios where the PSA has increased so much that even if it were to come down somewhat, we might still be concerned about that PSA value. So there are times that we may move straight to biopsy. But in general, just like the previous slide showed, there are other ways that PSA can be elevated or reasons. We want to make sure that there's not one of those present before we go to the biopsy. PSA greater than 4 would be concerning, or a PSA rise greater than 1 in 1 year. Or again, that PSA, the free PSA to total PSA ratio of between 10% to 25%, but definitely if it's less than 10%. The staging, that overall group stage that we talked about, begins with PSA as well. So not just screening, but actually the staging. So low risk is going to be, or stage 1 is going to be less than 10 nanograms per milliliter. Intermediate risk is going to be between 10 and 20 nanograms per milliliter. And then high risk is going to be greater than 20 nanograms per milliliter. And in general, most of the time we see prostate cancer below 10 or between 10 and 20. It's relatively uncommon, especially with PSA screening, to see PSAs greater than 20, although it definitely can happen. After the PSA, the clinical exam is the next step. And so that's the every man's favorite part of their annual physical, is the rectal exam. And it is important because it can detect if the prostate cancer is growing out from the prostate gland. So you can see that the rectum, located on the left side of each of these diagrams, is located right next to the prostate. And if you have a small prostate cancer, such as a T1 prostate cancer, you're not going to be able to feel it on the rectal exam. But if the cancer is growing out from the prostate and is actually contacting the rectum, or at least it's pushing the membrane to touch the rectum, then that's going to be something that your doctor or your advanced practitioner is going to be able to feel or palpate on exam. Clearly, if the cancer is growing into the seminal vesicles or potentially completely out of the gland, invading into a nearby structure such as either the rectum or the bladder, then we're going to go into what we call a T3 or T4. And all of these factors are going to go into the overall stage group. So if we look at additional things to evaluate, including besides the PSA and the physical exam, it's going to be a multi-parametric 3-Tesla MRI. You can see here that on the left-hand side of the screen that there is a normal side of the gland and then a very abnormal side of the gland. And so the normal side of the gland, the peripheral zone, which is the outside of the prostate, normally has this white, almost salt and pepper type appearance to it. And that is a very normal way that the glandular part of the prostate will appear. But then if you look on the left-hand side of the screen, there is this dark, intense disruption in that normal appearance of the gland, and that is where the cancer is located. So in this case, there is a black arrow pointing to the cancer, and then we have a white arrow pointing to the normal part of the gland. There's also something called advanced PSA testing. One of the companies that does this is the 4K score, and that's where we're testing additional blood protein markers to see if the PSA is elevated, what is the chance that if we do a biopsy that we're actually going to find a clinically significant prostate cancer. So if you have an elevated PSA, and potentially if you have a normal 3-Tesla MRI of the prostate, we might be able to run this 4K score and then help us further determine whether or not we actually need to do a biopsy or not. So the high-definition MRI, again, another picture here, allows us to look inside the prostate. And it's not just the appearance of the gland, it's also the function of the gland or the density of the gland. You can see here that there are diffusion-weighted images where we're able to identify on the right-hand side of the screen that not only does the area look abnormal, but it's also more dense. And so that's what you see, that dark area where that white arrow is pointing on the right-hand side of the screen, showing that area of increased density. And prostate cancers, or cancers in general, as the cells grow together and become more clumped or associated with one another and start crowding next to each other, that's going to increase the density. And on MRI, how water travels through tissue, whether it travels in a normal predicted way or a restricted way where the water can't get through the tissue, that's what the MRI allows us to do. So before we ever put a needle in the prostate, we can take a look and see, is the prostate concerning or potentially is it not? So here the 4K score, some data showing that the probability of developing distant metastasis can be predicted with this blood test. So that's very helpful to tell us that if someone has an elevated PSA, not only what's the chance that we're going to find clinically significant prostate cancer, but also what's the chance that we need to be worried about a cancer that, if it is present, actually spreading to other parts of the body. So again, this can be obtained even before a biopsy is collected, and could tell us if we need to be worried or not. So once a decision is made that a biopsy is needed, there are different ways to do that biopsy. The most common way is through a urologist's office, where it's a transrectal ultrasound-guided or TRUS-guided biopsy. And that's where a probe is placed into the rectum, and then anywhere from 12 to maybe 14 or 16 needles will be placed throughout the prostate to get a very good assessment or map of where cancer may or may not be located. An alternative to this would be using an MRI-directed biopsy where someone is actually inside of the MRI unit, and you can see with precision that the needle actually goes into the lesion. That may involve fewer needle sticks and be more precise, although there are some systems that fuse the MRI images with the ultrasound unit and create a fusion biopsy, so that would be a hybrid in between these two concepts. So pathologic analysis, we're going to involve two different ways of thinking about this. One is the histology, what the cancer looks like under the microscope, and then also the genomics, so not a person's genetic background, but specifically what genes or gene sequences that a cancer may or may not possess, and are there any amplification or cell proliferation genes that are amplified, things that are associated with growth or invasion, are they present in higher concentrations than a typical prostate cell? And that's what the genomics can test, and there's several companies that test for this. So in general, as we look at the histology, there is a grade of 1 to 5, and that is the Gleason score. We will have normal cells and normal appearing glands with a pattern 1, where we have very, very abnormal cells with a pattern 5, essentially that you can't recognize that it comes from a prostate cancer. And so that's what we'd call poorly differentiated. And so a well-differentiated tissue looks like normal tissue, whereas poorly differentiated is going to look very abnormal and not like normal prostate at all. So here's another example of that spectrum of starting at the top of the slide with normal appearing cells and glands, and then moving to very, very abnormal cells and glands as you move from a pattern 1 down to a pattern 5. In general, we think of 3, 4, and 5 as being the portions that of the scale that are involved with cancer, and we'll talk about how that 3, 4, and 5 are used here in just a moment. But as you think about it, the cells need to look abnormal to be a pattern 3, and the glands need to start looking abnormal in general to be a pattern 4. For pattern 5, we generally see breakdown of the tissue or necrosis. There are some exceptions to this, but in general, those are the things that we're looking for under the microscope. So with the Gleason score, we always have a primary and a secondary Gleason score that we will add up to give our overall Gleason score. So many of you in the room may say, well, my Gleason score is actually a 7, but you said the scale is 1 to 5. And the reason for that is that there is both a primary number and a secondary number. So pathologists, in our case, our pathologist, Bill, will look under the microscope and he will say, you know, this mainly looks like a pattern 3, but then he will always scan and look to see if there's any areas that look either better or potentially look worse, and that's going to be the secondary number. So your Gleason score is always going to be a combination of two different reads that add up to one number. And we always take the highest number. So even if you have 3 or 4 cores that have prostate cancer, it's the highest number that we take forward to come up with the overall stage. And so in this example, we see here that we have a 3 plus 4. So the primary number is 3, the secondary pattern is 4, and there's an overall pattern 7 that's present. And so what it looks like under the slides of a pattern 3 and a pattern 4, again, having that 7. But you can also have a pattern 7 with the reverse present. So if we look on the next slide, the 4 is the predominant pattern, but the 3 is the minor pattern. So still a Gleason 7, however, it's going to be oriented where there is more pattern 4 than pattern 3. And what we know about Gleason 7, 4 plus 3, is it actually behaves clinically more like a Gleason 8 than it does a Gleason 7, 3 plus 4. So that's important, and if you have a Gleason 7, it's important to know what your primary number is and what your secondary number is. So here are overall grade groups, which we're moving to in the most recent classifications and NCCN guidelines. And so you may actually hear someone say a grade group as well, which is another way of combining the Gleason scores into a category. So in general, Gleason 6 is a grade group 1. Gleason 7 is either grade group 2 or 3. If you have 4 plus 4, or any pattern 5, it's going to be grade group 4 or 5. And that is important because these higher grade groups, we believe, probably have a higher familial link and potentially might need to talk with a genetic counselor about gene testing in the family. The reason that the grade groups are important is here on this slide. You can see that the risk of having a recurrence after surgery is going to be higher as the Gleason score goes up. So one of the questions that I often receive is, you know, doc, shouldn't I get surgery if my prostate cancer is worse or if it's more severe or higher grade? And what I would point to are data like these that say that actually as the grade group goes up, the chance of surgery alone being successful is going to be less likely. So that grade group or overall Gleason score is really helpful in telling us the probability that the cancer is truly located in the gland, or maybe is it sitting right next to the gland or nearby where it might be out of the reach of surgical resection. Here's a very large chart, which I promise there won't be any tests at the end of this session to cover this, but it is a good reference to be able to put all the information together of a risk group, some of the clinical pathologic features, whether we need to do imaging or not, molecular testing if it needs to be performed, as well as does genetic testing need to be done in the family. And again, molecular testing being those genomic tests if we need to or not. I will say that I, even though this chart says not routinely recommended, I find that the genomic testing can be helpful for some limited, intermediate, and high-risk patients, especially if we're trying to understand the biology of the tumor a little bit more. And I think that that's going to change over time as we collect additional data. So overall stage, again, a very busy slide here, but important to say that the overall stage group is a combination of different numbers. So if someone, you know, on the street or at church asks you, what is your stage? You can say, well, it's this overall stage group of stage 1, 2, 3, or potentially 4. And in general, the stage groups are very similar in between most different cancers. So that's going to take into account what the physical exam is, what the PSA is, and what it looks like under the microscope, but also what the MRI shows. And many physicians will include MRI data in coming up with their overall stage. This overall stage slide here, I think, is helpful because as you talk to other people, maybe in your family or friends, you can help relate the cancer that you have, your stage group, to maybe other types of cancer. So in general, and there are some caveats, some differences to this, but stage 1 and 2 means that the prostate, the cancer is limited to the original site. So whether that is lung cancer or breast cancer or prostate cancer, in general, stage 1 and 2 is a localized prostate cancer or lung cancer or breast cancer. Whereas stage 3, in general, denotes that there is some regional spread nearby. And stage 4, for most cancers, there are some exceptions to this, most cancers mean that the cancer has spread elsewhere in the body. So you can combine in and say stage 1 and 2, relatively localized or maybe a single lymph node in some cancers. Stage 3, you know, more evidence that the cancer has spread somewhere nearby. And then stage 4, potentially distant to a distant site. So this can help you not only to understand your own cancer, but potentially if someone else comes up to you and says, hey, I have stage 3, you know, cancer, whether it's lung cancer or breast cancer, you can help understand, you know, where that cancer may be located or has it spread or not.